The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
All right, welcome to a Monday, everybody. I was going to start with a song today. A familiar song for those of you who've been listening to the show for any amount of time. It's by a singer-songwriter named Cheryl Wheeler. It's called If It Were Up to Me. You know, it goes, I'd take away the guns. But how many times have I played that? It doesn't make a difference. And since this shooting was specifically targeting the LGBTQ community, and apparently this shooter had a thing about transgender people and drag shows, I thought today we would hear one from Kinsey Six. Take it away, girls.
Which side are you on? 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 Which side are you? Which side are you? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
When you hear Black Lives Matter, do you get annoyed? Does it push some buttons you'd rather just avoid? Why you feel this way does not need Sigmund Freud. If you do not have to fear, you'll be the next George Floyd.
If you're not black, here's one guideline. Do not sit back on the sidelines.
I won't look away, I won't look away. I won't look away, I won't look away.
We can't look away, we can't look away, we can't look away. We can't look away, we can't look away.
There's always some good reason, that reason isn't pleasing. They like it open season, that's why protest is treason. But you learn if you're white, don't fight, just keep it light. Being impolite gives fright, keep your lips tight and you're all right.
We win comfort with our silence, but our silence sanctions violence.
Time to take a stand, time to take a stand. Time to take a stand, time to take a stand. Time to take a, time to take a, time to take a stand. Time to take a stand, time to take a stand.
They want us cynical, they want our cowardice. They know us shutting up, keep others powerless. And the same power that will kneel on one man's throat is the power that's working every hour to suffocate the vote.
Make a promise, make it formal. There's no going back to normal.
If your party's base's latest taste is to embrace a racist, is a safe space for the case that women and blacks should know their places.
Praise for those who praise a man who preys on those with darker faces. Build a wall and Jews will not replace us are their favorite phrases.
Hazes Asians on workplaces, slams of trans and gays.
Praise Jesus!
Then debases using photo op showcases to win races.
We will not let you erase us. Haters get no safe oasis.
Which side are you on? 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 Which side are you? Which side are you? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
Spread the word, shit's been stirred. We will be heard on November 3rd. Spread the word, no more dreams deferred. We will be heard on November 3rd.
Spread the word, shit's been stirred. We will be heard on November 3rd. Spread the word, no more dreams deferred. We will be heard on November 3rd.
If your party's base is latest, taste is to embrace the racist. Is a safe space for the case that women and black should know their places. Praise for those who praise a man who prays on those with darker faces. Build a wall and Jews will not replace us are their favorite phrases. Jesus, Asians on their places, slams the chance and gates with Jesus. Then they face it, Jews can follow up, show faces, Jews and races.
We spread the word, no one dreams of you
with us.
We will be heard, no one dreams of you with
us. Have you heard, we've been spurred. We're in this fight till November 3rd. Have you heard? We've been spurred. We're fighting long past November 3rd.
Yeah, oh yeah. Kinsey Six is who they are. That is K-I-N-S-E-Y-S-I-C-K-S. Find them on the YouTubes. They're a brilliant a cappella group of trans women. I guess, or drag queens. I don't know how they describe themselves, but they are talented. And I thought today we'll start the show with one from them. Now, I could have played something funny from them because some of their stuff is just incredibly, like, really funny. Like, I'll give you a quick taste. We won't play the whole thing, but to give you an idea of what we could have done. Here.
Yes, no, you're in church now. Talk back to me. We all know pain and suffering, don't we?
Yes.
And we all know love, too.
Yes.
Of course, I've known more love than you have.
Okay.
But this very special message I would like to leave with all of you this evening.
Here we go.
Was feeling so bad.
I thought it was going to kick right into the chorus, but give it a second. You'll see. We got a minute here.
The preacher, he said that I'm going astray. So I got down on my
I think I picked the wrong song to make a point, but it's okay. Just a minute. We're going to let them kick in. And...
what else would I be doing? I spoke to the Lord, yes, I did. And here's what God
I wanted them to get to the punchline really fast, but okay, here we go.
Be a tramp, be a tramp, be a hussy, be a vamp. Now do not let a preacher but not want a feeling feature tell you what to do and who you can't.
Okay, you get the idea. Right? All right, so that goes out to all the prudes and all the haters on the right and the assholes who think that it's a, you know, who think that it's appropriate to take out your own hatred by shooting up a room full of innocent people. I don't know what to say anymore with these shootings. I don't. So there's that. It happened again, and it will keep happening until something changes. And I'm not going to dwell on this because, you know, I sound like a broken record, but something has got to change. Joe Biden said, give me control of both chambers of Congress. Give me enough of a majority to get passed, and he didn't use these words, but manch enema. And we'll have an assault weapons ban again. We didn't go quite that far. But we're still fighting on. Past November 3rd, past November 8th, into as far as we can take it. Because something's got to change. Meanwhile, Lauren Boebert, who is from Colorado, tweeted out her thoughts and prayers. Take your thoughts and prayers and shove them up your ass. And to her opponent, who conceded the race over the weekend, 500 votes separated you. This goes to an automatic recount. You had to concede? Why don't you just say, let it go through the proper steps, do the recount, and we will respect whatever the official outcome is. I'm just over it. All right, so, you know, welcome to a Monday, everyone. This is a short week, and it's a week to be grateful and thankful, but it's hard to be when it starts off like this, with another goddamn mass shooting. This is a hate crime. This is somebody who, whose uncle, was it? I don't have the thing in front of me. You know what? I should wait till we get Digby on because she probably knows. But a close relative is a maggot state assemblyman, I think, in California in the San Diego area. Hate breeds hate. There's a song that I can't play because, you know, we're on the interwebs and YouTube and I'll get copyright violated, but it's from the musical South Pacific. And it's called Carefully Taught. You've got to be taught to hate and steal to, you know, I don't remember the lyrics offhand because it's been a while, but it's true. Little children don't know from this crap. But as these maggots get older, they infuse the hatred into their youngins. All the while they accuse us of grooming our kids. They're the ones indoctrinating them to hate and violence. It's got to stop. All right, so there's other news this week, too. We have, you know, we find out this weekend, thanks to a report from the New York Times, that remember the Hobby Lobby Supreme Court decision from 2014? We're going back 8 years now. I remember it very well. When the Extreme Court ruled that a company like Hobby Lobby that's closely held by a religious zealot, I'm couching my words, a religious zealot owner, the owners of Hobby Lobby, that they are the ones who brought this case all the way to the Supreme Court because they didn't want to have to pay for their employees' birth control. Because they're good Christians, don't you know? Now, they're not going to pay for the unwanted product of an unwanted pregnancy when the mother couldn't get birth control because her employer wouldn't include it in the health insurance plan that the employer should have nothing to do with anyway. And they won't pay for the abortion, of course, and they won't pay to help support the unwanted human being that results from this. It's infuriating. So Hobby Lobby brought this suit and they won. The Extreme Court said, you don't have to. You're a Christian. You don't have to pay for your employees' health care. Well, you've got to pay for some of their health care, but you don't have to pay for their birth control. And you certainly don't have to pay for those unwanted brats that they're going to have running around. Ugh. But that's not all. That's not as far as it went. You see, what happened is there was an anti-abortion leader among this religious community, this activist world. This anti-abortion leader, a Reverend Rob Shank, apparently has had a change of heart. And he spoke to the New York Times and he sent a letter to Chief Justice John Roberts and elaborated that he was given advanced information of that decision in that 2014 Hobby Lobby case before the Supreme Court, and that he shared that information with the president of Hobby Lobby so that he, in turn, could use that to launch a PR campaign and, you know, and massage or, you know, further manipulate the news to his purposes. So that's two big leaks from the Supreme Court. Now, you remember all those crazy maggot folks were screaming, you got to investigate the leak. Who leaked the Dobbs decision? You know, the decision of the case that overturned Roe v. Wade. Well, you know what the two cases have in common? Other than they both, you know, said fuck you to women and our rights. The things that both these cases had in common were the opinion was written by Justice Samuel Alito. Sam Alito. Two big leaks. The 2014 Hobby Lobby case and the Dobbs case that overturned Roe v. Wade. Samuel Alito was the author of the majority opinion in both of those. And both of those were leaked. Say it with me. Sam Alito is the leaker. Now, for all those right-wingers, Republicans who were screaming, investigate, find out who leaked it. You got them right there. Sam Alito. Impeach the motherfucker. And while you're at it, take Clarence Thomas with him. Got it? Okay. I'm pissed, and I need to not be, because we have Digby coming on today. So I'll tell you what, where is my Digby? There it is. I'll tell you what, let's do this. I'm going to get Digby on the line, and we'll sort of start over. Okay. So let me put up the show graphic and, see if I can't find, oh shoot. I need to do this over here though, because I'm calling Digby there. Give me 1 second. I got to bring her up on a different input. Otherwise, she's not going to be able to hear her intro. And you know, it's really important that she be able to hear her intro. So with no further ado, let me dial the phone and get Digby on the line. Okay, so we're going to do this. And we're going to do this.
What's that, Leonardo? Who's Nicole Sandler's next guest? Why, it's Digby, of course. Who's Digby? Observe, Leonardo. That's Dig for Dig and B for B. Digby.
Ah, hello, Digby.
Hello, how are you?
I would have been better if there was not a big shooting in Colorado last night. But, yep. You know, hey, it's another day in America, isn't it?
Absolutely. Another day, just like so many. You know, it's insane. I was just watching also on TV before I came on about how they barely thwarted an attack on a synagogue in New York.
Yep.
A couple of complete crazies there ready to go and shoot up the place. So barely averted a double horror.
That's right.
And basically just have the one absolute horror. And this is just how we roll in America. It's like it's barely even, you know, barely even a blip. I mean, you know, one of the things, I don't know if you heard this or not, but, you know, Uvalde down in Texas, where they had the horrible school shooting earlier in the summer. Did you know that they all voted for, not all,
yes.
I'm sure the parents didn't, but they voted overwhelmingly for Greg Abbott.
Unbelievable. See, that's what I don't get. They know it's his policies that put them in this position. And yet they do the same thing over and over again. How do you do that?
I just don't know. I mean, it's as if they're like indoctrinated. They're in a trance. They're, I don't know, brain damaged. I mean, it's just something where, it, you know, I mean, I realize, you know, people get, you know, locked into positions. It's very hard to move people off of beliefs and ideas that they have. But this is really insane. I mean, we're talking, I mean, this is just, you know, classrooms full of dead children.
Right.
Nightclubs full of, you know, dead, you know, brothers and sisters and neighbors. You know, schools all over the country having to do these horrible, you know, shooter drills.
Yes.
You know, this is the attacks on hospitals now. Now they're going after hospitals that do, you know, gender reassignment surgery.
My God.
I mean, this is crazy town. I mean, this is absolutely insane. And yet, I see no evidence that any of these people are budging. Do you?
No,
I mean,
no. And the voting data from Uvalde says it all. I mean, this is a small town. They are direct victims of this Republican gun policy. And they said, yeah, you killed our kids. This is insane. It's horrible. But hey, come back for another term.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, this, I mean, look, I mean, everything in that state, I mean, it's a Republican run state. And the reaction after that shooting, I mean, that was one of the most bizarre things that I've ever seen. And, you know, watching this story unfold in Uvalde, and it's really worth kind of looking at especially when you compare it to what happened over the weekend at the Q nightclub in Colorado Springs. there in the nightclub, you had, you know, it was some adults, and apparently I just read the story about the guy who actually went and beat the shooter down. He happened to have been in Iraq and Afghanistan, war vet and yes. officer.
Yes. And what happened to him? Yes. Let's talk about this for a moment. So the shooter was only stopped because two of the patrons in the club, who were unarmed, by the way, tackled yep. this guy, knocked him down, took his gun, hit him over the head with it. They demobilized him and held him until the cops got there. And so they saved probably hundreds of lives, right?
Absolutely. I mean, it's an astonishing story. I mean, we're just sort of getting the details now. This guy was the officer. He was he'd been out of the service since 2013 or something, so he's not active duty. But he was there with his wife and his some friends to watch the drag show. So, you know, he's just there as a patron watching the drag show. I mean, you know, I've been to drag
yes.
shows many times. You know, I mean, it's totally normal thing to do. So he's watching the show, and then all of a sudden the shooting starts, and he gets up, and he runs toward the shooter. This is his instinct to do, as he's a trained, you know, killer in the military. But guess what? You know, as he's down there pounding this guy, he's going, hey, help me, help me. And somebody, one of the patrons, comes up and grabs the long gun that the guy had and put it out of the way. And then one of the drag show actresses, that were dancers, I guess, came down and started kicking the guy with her high heels.
I love it.
And to keep him down. And I guess really did some damage, you know, with the high heels. I mean, this is, but, you know, is this what we have to do in America?
Yes,
I mean,
but.
Really, you've got to be prepared to go and take somebody out with your high heels and hope to God you've got some military hero in the crowd, because otherwise, who knows what will happen? I mean, this is, you know, absolutely horrifying. And by the way, that story about the guy who did it, at the end of the article, this is in the New York Times, they say that he was covered in blood. The cops came in,
yes.
grabbed him,
yes.
handcuffed him, and put him in the back of the car for an hour, and wouldn't
let him out. He didn't know if his friends and family were alive, and they treated him like he was the shooter. What the hell?
I mean, I get the fog of war and everything, but, you know, somebody could have just said, hey, dude, you know, or asked somebody, you know, did this guy do it? I mean, I mean, a whole hour of sort of being stuck in there. I mean,
I just read that moments before the show started, and I was nauseated by this.
I was shocked, too.
Unbelievable.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, one of the other things, again, going back to the Uvalde thing, you know, you remember after the thing happened in the very, I think it was in the, they didn't do the normal things. We knew something was really hinky about the response, because they didn't do the normal, there's a routine, you know, a protocol for holding press conferences and having the people come out and they give information, maybe go to the hospital.
Right.
I mean, you know, we've seen a million of them. So I'm going, what's going on here? They're not doing that. Instead, they had the political people come down. And they met in an auditorium. Do you remember? And they all sat up on a dais, and it was the governor
and
the lieutenant governor.
Yes.
And they all said, we want to thank our first responders. And it was the head of the Department of Public Safety and all these people. And you're going, wait a minute, this isn't how it's done. Usually, you know, you're not talking about that. You have somebody out there giving actual information to the media. No, they didn't do that. In fact, Beto O'Rourke showed up, and he's challenging them. These
yes.
are your policies.
And they're like, get him out of here. What's this guy doing?
Get him out.
He should have been up there with him if they were going to do it like that. But instead, they ridicule him and kick him out.
It was insane. And so, you know, it was clear there was a cover-up going up from the very beginning, right? I mean, to me, I'm going, something is not right here. This makes no sense. Well, as the story has been uncovered, of course, you find that, I mean, and it gets worse and worse. CNN has somebody, I think his name is Shimon Prokopets. He's been following the story the whole time. And he's down there doing these exposés. And every time it comes on, I'm just shocked again that they, you know, they're doing these timelines. And it, you know, they just sat there. And nobody took charge, and they just let it happen, and they knew those kids were in there. I mean, that's obvious that they knew it was happening. So there's a horror show. You've got, you know, tens of, I don't know how many people were there, you know, 30, you know, the cops of various agencies were there on the scene, and they didn't do anything. And here you have up in a gay nightclub in Colorado over the weekend, you have somebody coming in and mowing down people with one of these horrible, semi-automatic rifles,
right.
And two people in the crowd go and take them down. I mean,
that's
right. It didn't. All those cops with all their armor and everything, they didn't do it. So somehow or another, things just aren't really. You get the feeling in this country, don't you, that you're on your own?
Oh, without
that basically, it's every man for himself, every woman for herself.
Without a doubt. Yep. It further depends on where you are, frankly.
Yeah.
In Florida, I don't expect anyone to come help me because I'm not a Rick Scott. I'm not a Ron DeSantis sycophant. That's what it takes now in this state to get any kind of help because they believe today's Republican Party apparently believes that you are only American if you are one of them, and if you believe the way they do and look the way they do and worship the way they do, otherwise you are the enemy. They don't believe in, one nation under God or not. They believe that we are split, but let the Democratic president make a speech calling out the MAGAs, and he's the most divisive president ever. Delivering the most divisive speech ever. The hypocrisy is just, I shouldn't be surprised by it, but it continues to astound me.
Well, the hypocrisy has been retired on that side. It's no longer an operative concept. They don't care. And that is because, really, what they are is completely shameless. And shamelessness is a very, very powerful and potent tool. It means that society really has nothing, they can do nothing outside of, the legal process to stop anybody from just doing whatever they want. I mean, there's no social sanction will do anything to, if you're shameless, then nothing can affect you that way. And that's exactly where they're at. They don't care. They're laughing in everybody's face. They're basically saying, what are you going to do about it? Yep. I mean, that's, Trump in a nutshell. I think DeSantis is the same way.
Oh, DeSantis.
I mean, he seems to revel in being up in your face, and just kind of,
You know what?
Where woke goes to die.
Yes. And Digby, I've got to thank you because a post you have up at digbysblog.net is the earlier today on DeSantis. And you say, hold on, let me scroll. DeSantis summons his own cult. And you know what? Thank you for calling him out because I've heard too many, media personalities basically give him a pass. Like I heard Ali Velshi the other day talking about... the guy who won the governor's race in Nevada, saying, he's a Republican, but he's not as bad as some of the others. He's disavowed Trump. He's a DeSantis supporter. As if that's okay.
What?
DeSantis is not okay. DeSantis is every bit as dangerous and heinous a figure as is Donald Trump, if not worse, because he's better educated.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I have, no way do I in any way think that DeSantis is an improvement. To me, he is absolutely not an improvement. And in many ways, he may end up being worse.
Yes.
I mean, you and I have talked on this show a number of times about this sort of, Viktor Orban program on the right that is, sort of based on this sort of modern authoritarian nationalism. That's kind of it's a global phenomenon, and Viktor Orban is sort of the avatar of the whole thing. And these guys that DeSantis is the perfect model of that in the United States, and he is basically saying that. I mean, he doesn't evoke Orban's name necessarily, but when he was at this meeting over the weekend of the Republican Jewish Coalition?
Yes,
where it was kind of a pre-presidential cattle call kind of thing. A lot of the so-called challengers showed up for that. Well, Trump showed up too on video, and DeSantis, his whole thing was, we are a model. What we did in Florida is what we can do everywhere. Florida is where woke goes to die, and he was saying all this stuff. And there's a certain messianic quality to him too. That ad that they did before the election.
Yes,
Ron, I love you.
Oh,
and he had God sent a fighter and all. I mean,
okay, but Digby, because I spent a lot of time with that ad because I'm down here in Florida. Do you know the history of that ad? Do you know that it was
I don't think so. I don't think I know.
It was a direct ripoff of, brace yourself, of an ad for Dodge Ram trucks. I kid you not. You're not on the video, so you wouldn't see it. But here, I'm going to pull up the audio and just play a little bit of it for you. I'm going to email it to you because I'm blown away.
Oh, I'd love it.
Because I've been screaming about this for a couple of weeks, and it has. I thought this would go viral because it's offensive enough that this ad, you know, he's likening himself to God.
It's grotesque.
But yeah. It's grotesque. But then when you go back and you realize that it's lifted, I'm telling you, Digby, almost verbatim.
Oh, my
from
God.
This,
I can't wait.
Which was taken from a Paul Harvey speech. I know this sounds all so surreal. Now I got to find where it is. Hold on. Where did I put this ad? Oh, man, now I can't find it. I'm going to find it. Hold on. Give me a sec. But so Paul Harvey apparently did this speech back in the 70s. And Dodge Ram, for whatever reason, Dodge Ram truck ad Paul Harvey. So here's the audio to it. Here we go. Come on. It's coming.
And on the eighth day, God looked down on his planned paradise and said, I need a caretaker. So God made a farmer.
So God made a farmer. It, in Rod's ad, it was a fighter.
To get up before dawn, milk cows, work all day in the fields, milk cows again, eat supper, then go to town and stay past midnight at a meeting of the school board. So God made a farmer.
So God made a farmer.
God said, I need somebody willing to sit up all night with a newborn colt and watch it die and dry his eyes and say, maybe next year.
Okay, but
I need somebody who can shape an axe handle from a persimmon sprout, shoe a horse with a hunk of car tire.
Oh my God!
Right?
Can make harness out of hay.
Okay, but it gets better because I'm going to scroll. I'm going to go into it. I'm probably not going to find the right spot. But do you remember in the ad he talks? He holds up his little daughter. Boy, he loves pimping his kids out. And he's like,
no
"And my
kidding.
Daughter, and the daughter who's going to follow in his footsteps," directly from. The ad. Listen to this. Alden.
With smiling eyes, when his son says that he wants to spend his life doing what dad does. So God made a farmer.
It's the same. It's complete
wow.
plagiarism.
Wow.
I'm going to email you this, and I'd love for you
oh,
to write
dude,
it up because
that's...
I did, and I've been
I
railing
will.
On it, and nobody picked it up. And this thing needs to be pushed out there. Not only is he a heathen, just, you know, think too much of yourself, but he stole it from a fucking Dodge Ram truck commercial.
That is amazing. That is amazing. And remember, even before that, in fact, I'm going to write about this because this is too good. He did that whole Maverick thing, right?
Yes.
Where
yep.
he was you know, sort of some kind of fighter pilot.
Yep.
I mean, the whole thing. I mean, there's something wrong with him, right? I mean, this isn't
really.
I mean, this is really kind of weirdly abnormal. And he's an abnormal guy. I mean, I have my doubts. To be frank with you, that he's going to go the distance. I mean, you know him a lot better than I do, but you try and keep a pretty close watch on this guy because I think he's very dangerous. And to me, what you know, he has all the words and he has a nasty bullying attitude. He's certainly willing to use the government, you know, in whatever way necessary. I mean, maybe I talked to you about this before, but I think it's worth reiterating because I think it's actually quite true. The thing about Donald Trump is that he controls people around him through personal attacks and through, you know, his personal relationships with them. If somebody says something that looks at him sideways, he will insult them or do whatever, but he keeps people in line that way, and that's how he sort of wields his power.
Yep.
DeSantis doesn't do that. It's not personal. It's purely about using the levers of the power that he has, and that's much more dangerous as a some kind of a leader. Certainly, as a president, it would be very, very dangerous to have this person because, yes, it's terrible what Trump does, and it's obviously he's destroyed whatever vestige of the Republican Party was left
oh, without
when
a
he
doubt.
Took over.
Right.
But DeSantis is a whole different animal, and you know, he has many of the same impulses, but he has a smarter sort of approach to how to get his way and how to control people. And then you have this messianic complex that he has, which he clearly has. You look at, you know, just look at him. I mean, he obviously thinks, he thinks very highly of himself.
Yes.
He's got here this wife of his who's sitting on his shoulder, and she also thinks very highly of herself. And the two of them are quite a pair. And, you know, I think that he is truly, a dangerous person. But on the other hand, that personal thing that Donald Trump has goes in a number of different directions, right? The crowd, his crowd. I mean, to me, he makes my skin crawl just even thinking mm-hmm. about him, much less listening to him or looking at him. But the people to whom he appeals think they have a personal kind of connection with him. They believe that they're, you know, that somehow or another he really has their number. That he, you know, they always say he says what I'm thinking. Right,
right? He's one of us.
And I don't think that. Yeah, he's one of us, you know, the blue-collar billionaire. Isn't he great? And, you know, he's got the fabulous wife. DeSantis doesn't have any kind of a personal touch. I don't see any sense in him that, I mean, everybody says he's a cold fish.
He has no personality. There's no there. Did you see the debate between him and Charlie Crist? He's just, oh, my God, he's just this blank stare until it's his time. You wind him up, and he's like, everything.
And
he's
bored and just
mean. He's just mean spirited. He's a nasty, horrible man. And why
he is? And yeah, I mean, Trump is too. But there's something about Trump that people find
endearing,
entertaining, fun.
Yeah, I don't get it.
You know, but, I mean, I don't get it either. But you know, I accept that. You know, there's some musical acts that I don't get either, and I sort of look at him that same way. That, you know, whatever that appeal is, I don't see it. But I acknowledge that for some people, he really seems to have that. Those rallies of his are parties. Those people are having the time of their lives. They love being part of the Trump cult. Those stupid boat parades that they do, you know, the costumes that they put on. I mean, this is a whole kind of, you know, it's a cult, and it's a cult of people who are really, they enjoy being in the you know, welcoming arms of their fellow haters, right?
Yep. Oh,
they can just let it all hang out. Let their freak Trump flag fly. And DeSantis doesn't have any of that. I don't see it. You know, with
none.
Him, it's just pure, just grit your teeth nastiness. You know, yeah, well, you know, I'll stick it to you. Does that have the kind of appeal that Trump is going to have? That Trump has. I mean, will he have that?
I don't know. I hope not.
I don't put anything past the Republicans because they are all mean. You know, they seem to really enjoy meanness and nastiness. So maybe he'll be a big hit. But I kind of have my doubts that he's going to go the distance. And I always think of these other guys, you know, like, you know, Scott Walker. Remember him?
Yeah, I do.
I mean, he was the great white bread hope. I mean,
right?
That guy was going to take them over the top. Or somebody like Tim Pawlenty. Look at my smoking hot wife.
Do you remember Rick Snyder from Michigan?
Oh,
and look at Michigan today. Look at Michigan today. Yeah. Michigan rocked it in this election.
And
you know what Florida did? It cemented our move. We're moving to Arizona in April. We're out of here.
Wow. Well, at least Arizona is a real swing state, you know?
Yes. Well, it's turning blue.
You know,
and believe me, I was
need,
on...
They need some blue votes. Yeah.
They do. But I was watching that very closely thinking, uh-oh, if Kerry Lake wins... And DeSantis keeps on going here. I don't know where we're going to go because David won't go anywhere cold. So thankfully, Katie Hobbs won. And actually, Arizona, all the Democrats won. And that's where we're headed. I can't wait to get out of here.
You can reinforce the blue nature. Now,
yes.
I remember reading something recently that they were all upset, that a bunch of the Republicans were all upset saying it was all about the immigrants. From California.
Well, they're getting some from Florida too. So,
Well, that's what they say has to happen, you know.
Yeah.
And something happened in Florida. You know, Florida was a, was not a hardcore red state up until recently. I mean, you know, it was, I mean, it had its, you know, that side of it, but it was, a, you know, it was kind of a, it had everything.
It was
and
a purple
so
state.
It was a real swing state.
And Florida is, it's such a long, geographically, it's a strange state too. But South Florida, where I am, was always very blue. Northern Florida was, I used to joke, Northern Florida is the deep South. South Florida is the Northeast. Because it was. This is the Northeast. But now, Miami is Cuba North. And Broward, you know, Trump has invaded and brought his people. And the other part of it, and I've been, this is nothing new, the Florida Democratic Party is beyond useless. They are not only worthless, they're complicit. And Broward County, where I live, which was the bluest, you know, county in the state, the Broward County Democratic Party is so, just so horrible. They're offensive. I joined.
Is it corruption or just ineptitude?
Both. I think it's both. Do you know who they put in as chair of the Florida Democrats? Is Manny Diaz, and and he is just the worst person they could have chosen. And when that happened, you know, I came in as a precinct committee person thinking I'm going to be part of the progressive influx into the Florida Democratic Party. We're going to work from the inside out. And they elected Manny Diaz over a progressive. And I thought, this is not going to end well. And one of the first things he did was, instead of going after the Republicans, instead of going after DeSantis and Rubio and Scott and Trump, he wrote an op-ed in the Miami Herald dissing the Democratic Progressive Caucus of Florida.
Oh, for God's sake.
Yep, and that's when I said, that's it, I'm done. I'm out.
Yeah, I mean, that's just sad. You know, it's really, it is really sad. Florida is an important state. I mean, it's got a ton of electoral votes.
I know.
You know, a lot of congressional representatives. I mean, it's just... it's ridiculous to see it go that way. I mean, I'm, and it makes me, because it's not that kind of state. You know what I mean? It's as you say, it always had this kind of multicultural sort of thing about it. I mean, there are plenty of, you know, of African Americans.
Oh, yeah.
There's Latinos of all kinds, you know, Puerto Ricans and Cubans. And there was the Deep South up there in the Panhandle, you know, so you had your right wingers and all those transplants from New York, you know, so you had a lot of people that had retired down there.
That's right.
I just never thought I'd see the day that it would go this hard right for somebody like you know, Ron DeSantis. I mean, that is a huge disappointment. But it just goes to show you, you know, that if there's nobody down there fighting it, if the Democratic Party isn't doing its job,
nope,
they leave the door open.
Right, and they were horrible. This is what happened? They were horrible. And then Charlie Crist, look, he was the best choice we had. But let's face it, progressives, young people, aren't going to come out and vote for the former Republican. They're just not.
No.
We couldn't put up a decent Democratic candidate. You know, it's like they wrote the state off. And so I can't wait to get out of here because it is very different now. Anyway, so that's, you know, Florida, it's really sad. And up until this year, maybe it started last year, Democrats always outnumbered Republicans in voter registrations in Florida by like hundreds of thousands. This year, it flipped because the Florida Democratic Party sucks, because they may as well just go home. They need to get rid of Manny Diaz and everybody who's part of that and get them out of there and put in all new people. It's the only way they're going to turn the state around. And even then, I think they're going to have trouble.
It's going to take a lot of work, but it's not out of reach because it's still close enough. I mean, this DeSantis win was just
horrible.
You know, when I saw the numbers, that just made me sick because, of course, it was a large You know,
and
majority
that it wasn't only DeSantis that they won everything, and even Annette Tadeo, who should have won the seat in Florida's 27th district, that used to be Ileana Ross Layton's seat. She should have won that. And she didn't even come close. It's because of the propaganda, the Spanish language radio in Miami.
Yeah.
It's like nobody's monitoring it. I know there are some Democrats who speak Spanish. They're not monitoring it, and it's full on propaganda.
I just don't understand that, because I mean, it's one thing, you know. Look, I know it's a complicated problem. You know, not all Latino communities are the same. Everybody, you know, different regions have different concerns. There's a class issue that, of course, exists. You know, it's complicated, this whole concept about the Latino vote going right-wing. Yeah. And there's always been right-wing, you know, Cubans or people of Cuban, you know, extraction in Florida. I mean, that's been going on for, you know, 50, 60 years. But nonetheless, this idea that so much of this change has been driven by Spanish language media, and that the Democrats didn't think to really do anything about that. I mean, you know, you get on there and you compete, right? I mean, you put out, you know, I mean, I'm not saying you shut them down. I don't think you can, but
or you put on a competing signal. You do something, and they just like, oh well. I don't know what they did. They did nothing. They acted like, all right, if we ignore it, maybe it'll just go away.
Maybe it'll go away.
Right.
Well, that's a common problem. And look, we'll just, you know, we'll go and we'll show up at the farmer's market on Saturday, and that'll be good enough for whatever they do.
Exactly.
You know?
That's it. It's just, it's astounding. Yeah. So, yeah,
it's
I figured it's sad.
But you know what? Arizona's kind of a cool place. I think you'll like it.
I'm excited.
I mean, I know that they're a bunch of wing nuts, but obviously
there are
a bunch of cool people too.
Yes. So. And I have friends there, and it's that much closer to California, so I can come visit more often.
For sure.
I'll be better off out there. So, Digby, the other story I wanted to talk to you about is what broke over the weekend. So the Extreme Court, as I now refer to them, because there's nothing supreme about them anymore. You know, they were screaming, do the investigation, find out who leaked the Dobbs decision. I think we now know, because it's probably the same person who leaked the Hobby Lobby decision back in 2014. And now we know that was Samuel Alito.
Well, and I mean, this story, I mean, if people haven't read the full details on it, is really amazing, because this is a, quote, whistleblower from a far-right religious group, anti-abortion group, that he had revealed earlier in the summer. I mean, there was an earlier story here. It wasn't about specifically about this leak, but it was about this strategy that this group had put together to influence the Supreme Court, and they did it on a personal basis. They even set up their offices across the street so that they could, you know, make friends with and make contact with people who worked at the Supreme Court, so they would have these contacts within it. It's a very systematic thing. In fact, somebody described it as like something out of The Americans. Where you have this group that, you know, but basically infiltrated the Supreme Court, and they became friends with the justices and with their clerks, and they ended up socializing with them. And so I had heard this earlier in the summer, and I was astonished by this story anyway. And then this came out over the weekend, where the same guy says,
Reverend Rob Schenck.
And he had, one of the people he was affiliated with in the group told him that they had dinner with the Alitos, with Mr. and Mrs. Alito, and that they had said ahead of time what the outcome, that Alito was writing the decision and what the outcome was going to be.
Exactly.
And the idea was that they were giving them a heads up so that they could strategize around the ruling and they would be able to prepare for it. And this guy provided some, you know, it's not direct, documentary evidence, but it's pretty compelling stuff about, you know, one of the woman who allegedly told him, you know, there's an email there saying, I've got something really important to tell you, had dinner with the Alitos, you know, call me. Don't put it in email, you know. I mean, she told the New York Times, she said, oh, well, I got sick at the Alitos, you know, like, what, you couldn't put that in an email? I mean, you know, it's ridiculous. So this is an amazing thing. I mean, I am not surprised in the least about Alito, are you? Because you were involved with me. Well, you remember what it was when Bush put him on the court. We went crazy at the time, the progressives, trying to stop that nomination, because we knew that this guy was bad. I mean, he was really bad. He was a right-wing ideologue on a level and right-wing ideologue partisan,
yeah.
which was something we hadn't really dealt with so directly before. Now there are a whole bunch of them. You know, I think yep. Kavanaugh is a partisan, too. You know,
Amy Coney
they
Barrett.
All pretty much operate that way, yeah. But at the time, this was a shift because it was one thing to have, you know, you had far-right justices like, you know, Scalia,
yep.
of course,
yep.
or you know,
Thomas.
Rehnquist when he was on there. But they really were, they did come out of the sort of intellectual, you know, side of the conservative movement. And, you know, Alito, he was a far-right, you know, horrific horror show. But there were times when he sort of went, he had a sort of a libertarian streak when it came to policing, and he would often sort of vote against the conservative authoritarian side, and you know, which was always surprising, but he did do that. These guys who are partisans are, have a whole different project, right? I mean, their point of view is to keep Republicans in power. And they operate in tandem with the Republican Party in a way that we hadn't seen before. And I knew Alito. He was just a jackass. Do you remember him, you know, the way he acted at the State of the Union when Obama was giving
oh,
his
yeah.
speech and nodding
not
his, you know,
he mouthed not
and,
true. He mouthed
yeah.
not true. You know what?
Not
shut
true.
Up. You shouldn't even be there if that's how you're going to act.
Just, yes, stay
right?
home. Yeah,
yes.
stay home because you don't know how to behave in public.
That's
and you're
right.
a Supreme Court justice. You know, I mean, and yet we're supposed to honor them like, oh, you know, you're above it all and we can't question your wisdom or anything, and you know, or question your integrity. And you're sitting there screaming at the President of the United States, you know, not screaming, but, you know, mouthing, you know, a contrary statement to the President of the United States during the State of the Union. So anyway, we knew he was a jerk, and the fact that he wrote the Hobby Lobby and also wrote the Dobbs decision, and it was leaked ahead of time. It's exactly as you said
yep.
when we started. You know, when you brought this up, it's very, very. I mean, I don't think it's too much
no.
to assume that it was him. That he was the one who leaked this. And for the same reason that this guy says, Shank, says that he leaked the Hobby Lobby.
Right.
Which is to give their people,
give
their partisans
give them, yep.
time to prepare.
So let me ask you this,
didn't,
Digby.
Didn't work,
so this
but, you know.
This is what kills me. If the tables were turned, and obviously they wouldn't be, but say they were, and it was the Democrats who were the, you know, sleazy ones and doing all this shit, and the Republicans were in power, they'd be locked up in a heartbeat. The stuff that's dragging on, the you know, what's his name? Merrick Garland appointing a special counsel now? Why didn't he do this 2 years ago? Why now? I hear, I have Marcy Wheeler in one ear saying Merrick Garland is doing what he needs to do. He's putting all his ducks in a row. He's doing it methodically, so it's, you know, it'll be done right. I hear her. But there's that other part that says, what the fuck?
Well, I have to agree. You know, I mean, I listen, I read Marcy too, and I, you know, I am persuaded that she probably knows more about this than I do.
Right, me too.
Because she knows.
Right,
she knows everything.
But,
I also feel that this particular move at this particular time, that it played into an already. I mean, I think what they were trying to do was to depoliticize the investigations.
Yeah,
that,
you
and there
can't.
Are two
right.
that are the January 6th and then this Mar-a-Lago documents thing. That they're trying to depoliticize it and say, you know, look, you know, we're taking ourselves out of the equation. The decisions will be made by the special prosecutor, blah, blah, blah. You know, the usual. We've seen dozens of special prosecutors in our lives. But it did the opposite.
Yeah.
Because what it indicated was is that it was political up until now.
Yeah.
It's exactly what you say. You should have, if you were worried about this being a political case, you should have done it in the beginning.
Yep.
And you know, there was no way anybody, you didn't have to have Donald Trump officially announcing for it to be political or
no.
not political, because
right.
it's certainly not January 6th, which is inherently political. That's a political case, whether you like it or not. It was always a political case. They were trying to overturn the election. And then the Mar-a-Lago case, you know, it was clear. I mean, we all knew that Trump was, you know, exerting things like executive privilege
yep.
outside
yep.
of, you know, he's not in office and he was doing it. So that's inherently political, regardless of whether or not he was running for office again. So the whole idea of this now suddenly being, oh, well, now, you know, we need to go the extra mile make sure. It's like, who are you fooling? And,
right.
And what you know, what's the point? Now, the good news is, from what I understand, is that this guy, Jack Smith,
is supposed to be really
pretty good.
Good.
I remember hearing
right?
the same about Robert Mueller.
Me too.
But, you know,
yes, I remember that, too.
But I'm willing, you know, people who know more than I do seem to think that Jack Smith is a, you know, is a very straight arrow kind of guy. But I consider one thing here, Nicole. Jack Smith went into the public integrity unit of the Department of Justice after it had been discovered that the case against Ted Stevens had been sloppily done. That was done out of the Public Integrity Unit. You remember that. They built him a house.
Yep.
You know, he used government money for all that stuff. And so he went in there, and he kind of cleaned house in there, but the point of it was to punish the Department of Justice prosecutors who had, you know, wrongly investigated and indicted Ted Stevens.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I don't know what to think about that, but I know that Ted Stevens was a crook. Okay.
Yes.
I used to live in
and maybe right. And
there's
maybe
no doubt in
that. Right. Maybe in that one case, yeah, he wasn't guilty of what they. But he was
right.
a crook. He had a career as a crook, and yet
right.
they went after them for prosecuting him on one thing that maybe he wasn't explicitly
right.
guilty of.
And I think they withheld of. I mean, look, I'm not going to defend those prosecutors.
Mm-hmm.
If it was a sloppy and, you know, I don't know what, ideologically driven prosecution, that's bad. I'm not for that. The Department of Justice should be good, and maybe Jack Smith went in and did the right thing. And he cleaned up that division and, you know, made sure that everybody was, you know, that's what a straight arrow does, regardless, you know, without fear or favor. But I just have to say that, you know, every special prosecutor in my lifetime has been a Republican.
Uh-huh.
And we're talking, the last one who wasn't was Archibald Cox,
wow.
who Nixon fired.
Sure.
And, you know, they brought in, Jaworski, who was a Republican, who turned out to be a great guy and very, very, you know, I mean, the case wouldn't have gone forward without him. He, you know, back in the day when they had actual Republicans with integrity.
Yeah.
But they're all Republicans. So, you know, and this is the Department of Justice, which is, you know, the career people there are, they're full of Republicans. So I'm just withholding judgment here and just saying, you know, one man straight arrow, one girl straight arrow, whatever, can be another person's, you know, hardcore Republican.
Right, right.
And, you know, so I'll wait and see what happens.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think Garland is, or Lisa Monaco, who works for him. I mean, I think they seem to be, you know, I mean, I don't think they're Republicans.
No.
But I just don't, you know, I just don't know whether or not.
Well,
you know,
Merrick Garland is, though, I
believe. The moment
that
we're in requires
right.
more.
Yeah. And
I'm sorry, what?
I think Merrick Garland is Republican. I could be wrong. Either way, he's pretty conservative, which shouldn't even come into the discussion, but it has to.
Well, it has to, because this is, you know, the world that we're living in.
That's
now
right.
is that, you know, like Trump and his people, any special prosecutor that isn't a right-wing Republican Trump voter is, you know, can't possibly be partial in a Trump
right.
case.
Right.
I mean, that's how
is
they look at it.
Is an enemy of the country. I mean,
right.
that's how they govern. You know, God forbid Joe Biden says, well, I'm the president for everybody, whether you voted for me or not. Donald Trump said, if you didn't vote for me, you're not part of this. I don't want to hear from you. I mean, that's the difference. I mean,
oh, it's a huge difference. Remember, I mean, Donald Trump was the one who told California, you know, go pound sand. We're not sending any more
right.
money for your fire problem.
Right.
You know? I mean, this is how they are, and they really believe that. And the Democrats, of course, have not done that.
No.
So yeah, and again, you know, we sit here and question, you know, do you fight fire with fire? Can you fight fire with fire? Would it even work if it came from the other side? I don't know. But I do know that when you're dealing with someone like Donald Trump, and this is truly something I don't think people understand about him, he is the martyr to the cult that he has behind him.
Oh yeah.
His strength comes from beating back all these charges. He is considered, he's a martyr, he's persecuted, he is their Jesus, suffering the slings and arrows that they think are aimed at them, and that he's taking all the heat. He is their Jesus. So when you, you know, charge after charge after charge, you have, like, look at this Trump Organization case up in New York. It's basically a dud.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing's happening with Alan Weisselberg, right?
I mean,
nothing's happening there. You know, you've got all these cases that, you know, going from, you know, from when he first took office. I mean, from the thing about the what was it, the Trump University or whatever.
Yep.
You know, I mean, this goes on and on and on with this guy. It builds another layer of armor on him. And this is what they love about him, is that he keeps, you know, everybody's going, oh, we don't like losing, we're tired of losing, you know, this is Chris Christie and
yep.
the rest of them.
I'll say, yep.
well, he's a loser, we're tired of losing. They don't see him as a loser. They see him as a superhero, a real winner. He beats back everything they try to do to him. He wins every single time. And so I worry about this, right?
I mean,
if they better... They better get him, let's just put it that way, or they're going to be sorry, and we will have a strengthened Donald Trump going into the 2024 election.
Without a doubt, Digby. And that's, you know, it should, from all the great legal minds I've been reading and listening to, at least the Mar-a-Lago case is a slam dunk. And this he has to turn over to a special prosecutor? He should have handed down an indictment. And said, this guy thinks he can avoid prosecution by declaring his candidacy. Sorry, buddy, it doesn't work that way. Boom, indictment.
Yeah. I mean, I agree. And I don't. And it shouldn't work that way. It can't work that way, Nicole. If the system now is that, you know, just because you're running for office or you have some political position in America, that means that you are immune from prosecution. And nobody can do it. We no longer have a rule of law in this country. I mean, it's completely ridiculous. And the lesson that people are learning from that, and just look around the country at these Republicans, right? I mean, these people
yep.
who are running for office in various places, that's the lesson they're taking, is that they can get away with this stuff. You know, just be as you know, as bold and aggressive as you can be, and you can battle your way through it or at least survive. And, you know, this is a very dangerous thing. It's very, very dangerous. And he just keeps, you know, like, look at the Mar-a-Lago documents case is a perfect example of him and this problem. He could have just given them back. It would have been the easiest thing in the world. They come down and go, hey, you know, we understand you got some documents here. They're in some of your boxes. You know, we'd like to have them back. And he could have said, oops, oh, yeah, you're right. Geez,
yeah.
You know, I was in a hurry trying to get out of town, and I packed a bunch of stuff that, you know, my people, he doesn't even have to say he did
right.
it. My people packed up a bunch of stuff they shouldn't have in here. Just take all the boxes, and I'll, you know, come and look at everything later, whatever, but take whatever you need. That's all they had to do. Nothing would have come of it. They weren't going to go pursue him over that, you know, just if it had been a mistake. It was the defiance, right? It was
right.
him saying, no, I refuse. I'm
right.
not going to cooperate.
And it's mine.
These are mine.
These are mine. And every other
right.
president did it too. No, they didn't. That's the thing
of
about this guy. He makes shit up. And so you know it.
Oh my
they
God,
all did it. No, they didn't. You know.
Well, and his people believe it. You know, you've
I know.
Got tens of millions of people out there going, oh, yeah, they all did it. I mean, it's like, you know, what are you talking about? But, I mean, that's the big problem with him is that this is, there are, he goes beyond just breaking the law and or busting the norms. He does it consciously, saying, I don't have, and he says this in that case in particular, it's so blatant and so obvious. I don't have to adhere to your laws.
Right.
I don't have to. I'm me. You know, I'm Donald Trump, and I don't have to do that. These are mine, and you don't get to say they're not. And you know, do they just let that pass?
Can I tell you something? We're getting ready to move, so I'm going through boxes of old shit, and I'm a pack rat, so I save everything. And I'm finding a bunch of stuff from when Allison was little. And Allison was a really tough kid. She... I swear her first word was no. And I remember her first preschool going in and talking to the teachers, and they're like, we don't know what to do with her anymore. It's nap time. And we tell her to lie down. She said, you can't tell me what to do at two mm-hmm. years old. She's always been like this. So I saw a thing from kindergarten or first grade, and the note from the teacher is she will not listen. She just will not follow the rules. She had oppositional defiance disorder. I mean, she with ADD, she still pushes back on everything. This is what Donald Trump reminds me of. The little kid who says, you can't tell me what to do. No, I'm not doing anything you tell me to do. That's what I hear every time he opens his goddamn mouth. Your rules don't apply to me. Oh, my God.
Absolutely. I mean, that's why I'm sure he had it as a child, too. And I'm sure that's why old Fred sent him to military school. You know, I mean, that is the perfect description of him. He's like a toddler.
Yep.
And this is how he, you know, and he's never grown out of it. And, of course, he's been rewarded for it, you know, over and over and over again. The man is a very, very lucky person. In fact, I think he's just, you know, some people are very unlucky in life. And they just get, you know, they don't deserve all the horrible things that happen to them. And some people are just extraordinarily lucky. And it's like he is one of those.
Yep.
And it's just gotten him through everything. And he believes, he, of course, being a total narcissist on top of being a, you know, an oppositional defiance disorder, is a, you know, is a person who believes his own hype. He thinks that, you know, he has... he's a very stable genius. I mean, he even says that unironically now.
I know.
I mean, he doesn't even say it ironically.
Unironically. I'm your favorite president. I'm your favorite president. No, you're not. Stop talking like you're speaking for everybody. You're speaking for your followers. They're a tiny fraction, but they're loud.
Exactly.
They're loud.
Oh, no, he won in a landslide. It was just stolen from him.
Three times. Yeah. Oh, God. Digby, we could keep going, but
I know. Well, so the next time I talk to you, you're going to be in Arizona.
Well, no, we're not going till April now. So we were supposed supposed to go by the end of this month, and thankfully David figured out a way because I'm in no way ready because I got so much to do. So we're here till we have till the middle of April. So. We're good.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll talk to you before then. Then
I hope so. Digby, find her, of course, at digbysblog.net, at salon.com, on the Twitters. Have you tried anything else yet?
Oh yeah, I'm on all of them.
Yeah, Mastodon.
So, you know, if you go to my Twitter feed, if you go to my profile, you'll find all of my handles there. If you're looking.
Yeah, I'm
gonna wait and see what happens.
Me too, because God, Mastodon, they're so hard to navigate. Maybe it's that
it's
I'm
so
old,
hard.
But wow, I don't like it.
I'm tired.
Me too. Just leave it alone, Elmo. Go away.
I have Twitter. It was working fine, and now why?
I know.
Why do you have
why
to do this?
Why are you
to
doing
me?
This? Leave it alone.
Exactly. No.
All
but
right.
You know, I'll see where it lands. But yep. I have all these other handles. If anybody wants to follow me at the other,
got
the
it.
Other,
I'll
but,
find you there, know. And I'll follow you, even though I don't know what I'm doing at those other places. But I'll try.
I don't either.
All right, Digby. Thank you for hanging with us today. Always
My
a pleasure.
Pleasure.
And we'll talk soon.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Have a great weekend.
All right, you too.
Bye.
Bye. Digby, everybody. She is on Twitter at Digby56. And from there, you could get her other ats, her other handles, I guess, if you can figure. I'm on Mastodon. I'm on Counter Social. Both of them frustrate the hell out of me. So, you know, there's only so much I could do. I have stuff to do, you know. I got work. I got shit. By the way, so we... I'm here. I know I had told you that after the 23rd, I was going to be gone for a while, but I'm not because the move has been delayed till April. So, oh, okay. I was going to sign off, but I see I got a call coming in. So what the hell? We're in overtime. Hi, Dan from Goleta.
Yeah, how'd you know it's me?
Oh, because I have my ways.
I just want to say I'm really glad you talked about the Supreme Court BS. But one thing that you didn't mention that what I thought the most outrageous is that this reverend sent a letter to Roberts about this whole situation.
Yes, he did.
And just no reply.
And Roberts didn't reply?
Roberts didn't reply to the
guy. Wow.
Yeah,
so he did nothing. He was told that Alito leaked this 2014 Supreme Court decision, and Roberts did nothing.
Yeah, right.
Lovely.
And there was the article Saturday, but there's an article today in the New York Times and on the inner pages. And it says that this, you know, the Reverend sent Roberts a letter. He never heard anything, and he still hasn't heard anything.
Wow.
And to me, that's just like, you know, it's just
reprehensible.
Like, these guys are so corrupt.
So corrupt.
So corrupt. It's anyway,
and the code of ethics that governs every other, everybody else in the judiciary does not apply to the Supreme Court. For whatever reason, that is just
bullshit.
It's bullshit.
Bullshit. I mean, you know, but the thing is, this whole, like, Catholic clique in there, it's like they're all, like, you know, they're like bosom buddies, and it's all just BS.
Yep.
They all know, they're all, like, just, like, laughing behind our backs.
Yep.
And having these private dinners with wealthy people.
Yep.
And it's like, you guys are corrupt to the core. And then, you know, oh, well. Anyway, that's the one thing. It's just like, I was reading the article, and then I read about this letter on Saturday, and then I read it again today. I'm going, oh, my God. You know, you thought Roberts maybe a little bit.
No, and Stephanie in the chat room is asking, what can the Chief Justice do? He can do something. He knows that leaking a decision early is illegal. You don't do that. He should do. We should impeach. We should get Alito the fuck out of there.
He should come out and make a statement and ask Alito to step down.
That's
publicly.
Right. Exactly.
That's within his power.
Exactly.
And embarrass Alito and put him on the spot.
Exactly.
Because, I mean, that would be the ethical thing to do. If he doesn't have the power, just dismiss him.
Yep.
He can come out and publicly say he's requesting him to step down.
Yeah.
And that would create such shockwaves. But he hasn't got to do it.
He won't do
it. They're all in this.
Right.
I know.
Well, they should also have Clarence Thomas step down because he's a walking conflict of interest. Just his being there.
They had pictures of Thomas with this couple. Like, so, see, they're all, like, having dinners together and everything.
Right.
In Saturday's New York Times, there's a picture of Thomas and with this couple who, like, apparently, like, spilled the beans. And it's like, so it's like they're all just like this clique, you know? I won't.
Yep.
Anyway,
yep.
I just had to, like, get in there because I thought you mentioned it and you didn't have time because I had your guest.
There you go.
And it's like, to me, that's the most outrageous thing.
Yeah, it all is. You know, it all is. It's inconceivable. All right, Dan, thank you for calling.
Glad you're moving out. I'm glad you're moving out this way. That's good.
Me too. All right. Take care.
Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. So what I was starting to tell you before, and I know there's a few music people that hang out in the chat room. So I just got confirmation that I'm taping an interview on Friday with record producer extraordinaire Bob Ezrin. Now, I would think those of you who are the musicians are going, wow, really? Most of you probably don't know the name, and that's understandable. But Bob Ezrin produced, among other things, Pink Floyd's The Wall. I'm not even going to give you a whole list. Look him up. Bob, Ezrin. Bella Lugrisi is like, awesome, Nicole. Cool. Okay. So we are, and Chris, see, there's the ones I thought of. So I'm taping that with him on Friday. We'll probably maybe run it the following week. You know, December, we're going to have a lot of fun stuff too. So anyway, I'm really excited about that. I do have a history with Bob Ezrin. I'll fill you in on it when we do the thing, because we'll talk about we were internet radio pioneers together. And I'll leave it at that for now. But if you have watched that video that I posted of, yes, George knows. Yep, he's a legendary producer. Yes, he is. If you've watched the video that I posted of the video that I shot for my father 30 years ago this week, that I just put up on YouTube, there was a thing. We took a trip to Vegas for this music and technology big event. Bob Ezrin was the producer there. I didn't identify him by name at the time because I didn't know him at the time. But he was a big part of that too. So anyway, that's coming up. I'm excited about it. So we'll be here today. Tomorrow, Laffy will be here. I don't know what we'll do, something Wednesday. Thursday's Thanksgiving. I'm going to have on my annual Thanksgiving musical soundtrack for your Thanksgiving dinner. We do Alice's Restaurant and a bunch of other you know, songs, non-traditional Thanksgiving songs. So so we're here all week, and then next week, business as usual. We'll be here, all right? So that's it for today. I'll leave you with the news, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for hanging, everyone. Have a good night. Bye.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
It's almost expected here in the land of guns and insanity. Yep, another mass shooting at another club catering to a gay clientele. Club Q in Colorado Springs, Colorado was the site where a 22-year-old gunman killed at least five people and injured 25 others when he opened fire just before midnight on Saturday. Authorities on Sunday credited two heroic, unarmed patrons with subduing the shooter, who coincidentally has a history of violence. Police confirmed he was arrested in June of 2021 after a standoff at a home where his mother lived, when he reportedly made a bomb threat and other threats of violence. Colorado Governor Jared Polis, the nation's first openly gay governor, called the attack horrific, sickening, and devastating. President Biden responded to the tragedy with calls for gun reform and a plea to end LGBTQ hate. In New York, authorities on Sunday charged two men arrested late Friday at New York's Penn Station with multiple felony counts, including criminal possession of a weapon and making a terroristic threat in connection with an alleged plot to attack Jewish sites. Authorities said the developing threat to the Jewish community included plans detailed in social media posts about, quote, shooting up a synagogue. Police reportedly seized an 8-inch military-style knife and an illegally held gun with a 30-round magazine from the suspects. One of the two men, aged 21 and 22, also allegedly had a swastika arm patch and ski mask. Lovely. But crimes are also being committed at the highest levels in our society. The New York Times this weekend out with a damning report lobbing serious allegations that a second major Supreme Court decision was leaked in advance of its release. This time, the Times alleges that a former anti-abortion leader was notified of the outcome of the 2014 Hobby Lobby case involving contraception and religious rights. The Reverend Rob Schenck spoke to the Times and sent a letter to Chief Justice John Roberts claiming that he used the advance information for a PR push and added that he also tipped off the president of Hobby Lobby that he had won his case. Now, Senator Dick Durbin of Illinois, the chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, said the panel is reviewing serious allegations reported by the Times. So that's two major leaks, this one and the decision on Dobbs that overturned Roe v. Wade. What else do they have in common? Well, Justice Samuel Alito is the author of the 2014 case at the center of this new report. He also wrote the abortion opinion that leaked in May. There are no coincidences. In other meltdown news, Elon Musk reinstated the former guy's Twitter account over the weekend, continuing his wave of controversial moves after buying control of the platform. Trump was banned from Twitter in the aftermath of the January 6, 2021 attack on grounds of inciting violence. Musk claimed to have based his decision to reverse the ban on a Twitter poll. However, Trump himself appears to be still weighing the idea. He praised Musk's decision, but questioned whether the site would survive its current crises. Oy. In the meantime, Trump continues to post on Truth Social, the platform he launched after his Twitter ban. Elon Musk also reinstated Kanye West to Twitter. Oh, sorry, Yee, who continues to make light of his anti-Semitism. He immediately made his presence known by tweeting, "Shalom." I immediately blocked him again. Well, we now know that the 118th Congress will be a split government. Democrats controlling the White House and Senate, the Republicans sneaking by with the slimmest of margins to control the House. And it's looking more likely than not that current House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy will take over as Speaker of the House. But he's not there yet. He still hasn't banked the 218 votes he'll need to take the gavel. Meanwhile, current Republican Representative Adam Kinzinger, for the next month anyway, lambasted McCarthy on Sunday, saying he doesn't think McCarthy will last long as Speaker and will have to cut deals that'll divide the Republican majority. And finally, the COP27 UN climate summit in Egypt that ended with a historic resolution to help climate victims, is under fire for still doing nothing to curtail fossil fuel usage. Negotiators from nearly 200 countries agreed to set up a loss and damage fund meant to help vulnerable countries cope with climate disasters. They also agreed that the global community needs to cut greenhouse gas emissions nearly in half by 2030. But an attempt to address fossil fuels, the biggest source of planet warming emissions causing the climate crisis, was stopped in its tracks by a number of nations, including China and Saudi Arabia. Without their support, a key proposal to phase out all fossil fuels failed. But there is a little more good news. The U.S. and China, the world's two largest greenhouse gas emitters, have resumed formal climate talks after the latter froze negotiations this summer. Baby steps. And that's just a bit of what's news. For now, I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you consider making a contribution. My work is fully listener-supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com, and please click on that donate button.